Well, hello everybody, and a very warm welcome to today's webinar. This is going to be an athlete-led webinar on the theme of safeguarding and how we can make gymnastics a safer sport. So I'm absolutely delighted to be joined by all these people that you can see here up on the screen, members of the safeguarding working group that was set up by the International Gymnastics Federation. We have people from all over the world today joining us, people from Uruguay, from Canada, from Australia, from the Middle East. So nice to see you guys waving here from the FIG office in Lausanne. Hi. Great to have you all with us. So the Safeguarding Working Group, as I would say, was set up last year by the International Gymnastics Federation, FIG, with the idea of creating a positive cultural change in this great sport of gymnastics. So it's fantastic to be joined by everyone who's here today. And it's also fantastic to be joined by all of you who are watching from home or watching from work or wherever you are in the world. So thank you so much for getting involved in this webinar today. And as you'll see, as we go through today's webinar, there's a bit of an interactive feel to the whole thing. So make sure that you have your phones ready at hand. I know that's not a problem for most people in 2022 to have their phone nearby, because we're going to have a few quizzes. We're going to have little sort of discussions and debates where we want you guys to get involved, give us your thoughts, and then our athletes today from the working group will be reacting to that as well. So thank you for being here. Thank you to our speakers. I mean, it is our speakers, the members of this working group who wanted to have this webinar. They're the ones who want to get this conversation going about safeguarding, who want to open it up for debate, and they especially want to address young gymnasts and young athletes. So we hope that a lot of you are watching in today and can get involved in this conversation. So we're going to be together for maybe an hour and a half, 2 hours, depending on how things go. We're going to be hearing about lots of things about safeguarding. We'll be talking about the 10 golden rules. We'll be talking about changes in the code of conduct at the FIG. And we'll also be kind of giving a little bit of advice and maybe help for people who are, you know, people who aren't sure where to turn if they have problems in the gym. We'll be talking about that as well. So my name is Andrew Smith, or Andy Smith. I'll be just acting as helping out today as the moderator. But the real protagonists, the real people that we want to be listening to today, is our members here of this safeguarding working group. So we're now going to present the members of the group who are here with us today on this webinar. I'm going to start by handing over to Donatella Sacchi. Donatella is a former Italian gymnast, and she's the president of the Women's Artistic Gymnastics Technical Committee, I should say, and she also chairs this group. So Donatella, I know you just wanted to say a few words of introduction.
Yeah, first of all, hello everybody, and welcome to this very important webinar. FIG was very concerned about the safeguarding after listening the voices of the athletes around the world. Therefore, 1 year ago, the decision was to organize this safeguarding working group composed by athletes, by gymnasts. And I can say we accepted all the application we receive, and now we have this wonderful group of current or former gymnasts. It was a great honor and pleasure for me with work with them. They were so active. They had a lot of proposal, suggestion, looking to the future, how to improve our beautiful sport. I have to stop here because, as Andy said, they are the protagonists today, and it's good to leave the floor to them.
Perfect. Thank you very much, Donatella. Well, I'm just going to, for the time being, I'm just going to run through you who is actually here and tell you who the people are who make up the group today. There are a couple of absentees, but we have most of the group with us. So in no particular order, just in case you think we've ranked you or something, this is in totally no particular order, starting with Alex Kiroy. So Alex is with us from Australia. Well, I'm just trying to find you on the grid, Alex.
Hi.
Hi, Alex. So Alex, a rhythmic gymnast who currently represents Australia at the world level and also studying law. Is that right, Alex? Yeah?
Yes, that's correct.
Great stuff. Well, welcome. Then we move on to Iran. So a bit of a geographical hop over Sayed Reza Keika. Sayed Reza, who's just been taking part in the Asian Games. an artistic gymnast who represents Iran, and actually the first Iranian to have elements named after him in the FIG code of points. How did you get on, Said Reza? How did it go at the Asian Games? Good?
Hello. Yes, it was good. And nice to see you and everybody here.
Great to have you with us, Said Reza. Staying in the same sort of part of the world with Maria Barakat, who is a former member of the Jordanian national team. And she is now, and a former judge, is that right, Maria? You're a former judge as well in women's artistic gymnastics. Currently a coach and working for the Jordan Olympic Committee at the moment as well. So welcome, Maria.
Hi, everyone.
Victoria Filanovsky. Victoria is from Israel, a former rhythmic gymnast and a World Cup medalist as well. Works as a coach, works as a judge, and you have an MA in business and law, Victoria.
Yes, correct. Hello to everyone.
Yeah, so it's great that we have not only current gymnasts and current athletes, but also people who are going straight into other things and branching out into other branches of whatever they want to do next. Moving on then to Evdoxia Kosmidou. So another former athlete. I think pretty much everybody here today is a former athlete who works as a coach in rhythmic gymnastics, as an international judge, as a committee member, as an educator for the Department of Education. You like to keep busy, Evdoxia, I think.
Yes, so it's right. But I was an athlete long ago, not like the other athletes.
Yeah, and you do have a couple of days off every now and then.
No, I have no day off.
No days off. Well, great to have you with us, Evdoxia. Then we have Sasha Bertoncelli. Not Bertoncelli, as some people might think. He's not Italian. He's from Slovenia, a former pommel horse specialist, multiple World Cup winner, three-time European medalist as well, and now working in marketing and sponsorship. So welcome, Sasha.
Hi, Andy. Thank you for saying my last name right.
Well, I did get it wrong when we tried, when we tested it 10 minutes ago.
It was perfect.
Anyone that. Welcome, Sasha. Moving on to Emma Spence. Emma is with us from Canada, an artistic gymnast as well, a national team member for the Canadian team, and an NCAA gymnast at the University of Nebraska. Welcome, Emma.
Hi, thank you.
From Emma to Elsa Garcia, an Olympic gymnast from Mexico, another national team member and a graduate of fashion design, I understand, Elsa, yeah?
Yeah, hi, everybody. It's a pleasure to be here with you.
Welcome, Elsa. And then the last member of our working group, last but not least, Romina Castellini, who is from Uruguay. Romina, an FIG, a FIG brevet judge in women's artistic gymnastics, also a former gymnast. And you used to be president, Romina, of the National Women's Technical Committee in Uruguay, yes?
That's right. Hi, everybody.
Well, very much welcome. And we have two special guests with us today as well, two athlete representatives from the FIG Athletes Commission. Firstly, Dora Hegyi from Hungary. Hi, Dora. You are the athlete's representative for aerobic gymnastics, and I understand you just got back from the World Championships in Portugal.
Hi, everyone. Exactly. We just finished like 2 days ago. So.
And everything went well?
Yes, everything. And I have a lot of proposals already to the working group. So, yeah, fantastic. It was absolutely great.
Great to hear it. And finally then, Alias Pegan from Slovenia, probably a man who will need little introduction to those of you in the world of gymnastics, world champion on the horizontal bar back in 2005, and currently the president of the Athletes Commission. So welcome, Alias.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to the first webinar for the athletes. As a president of Athletes Commission, I would like to thank Donatella as a chair and all the members of the Safeguarding Working Group for their passionate work to prepare this webinar. To my opinion, the new approach taken by the FIG is the key to success, to include the athletes. As you already know, the Safeguarding Working Group consists mostly of athletes and former athletes. And they know the best what an athlete needs and how we can help when the help is needed. The athletes' representatives are present at every world championship. We organize athletes' meeting there. Some of us also served as safeguarding officers. We are trying to be present at as many other competitions as possible, and we always are there to listen to the athletes. We use every opportunity to talk to every athlete and to hear every opinion. As I said, at every world championship, we hold athletes' meeting. But unfortunately, in some disciplines, only a few athletes attend this meeting. And today, I ask you to pay more attention to this, express your opinion, and to share your thoughts or concerns with your representative. Our mission is to be a bridge between the athletes and the FIG. And as we can see, good cooperation between the top officials and athletes is the only way we could make our sport better and athletes friendly. And the last thing I would like to highlight today is the importance of the coaches. We must not forget them. Today we'll talk mostly about protecting athletes, but sometimes we must protect the coaches too. Our goal must be to get rid of the bad ones and to protect the good ones. Believe me that without good coaches, there is no future for us and for our beautiful sport. Thank you and enjoy the webinar.
Thank you very much for those words, Ali. As I could see, Sasha, a few people, and I could see a lot of people nodding along to what you were saying as well. So thank you very much for kind of launching us really into this webinar. So the theme, as we've been saying, is safeguarding. And now, actually, I'm going to just take a moment to speak to the people who are tuning in from around the world, because we're going to do something a little bit interactive today. We're going to be doing quizzes on a web. You can just see at the top of the screen, it says Mentimeter. And what we're going to be doing is we're going to be using Mentimeter to ask you questions where you can answer along on your phone. So I think if we can just get the code up, the QR code. And basically, when we're going to be using this thing to kind of give us some points of discussion, you know, we're going to be asking various different questions, and we would like all of you at home to take a few minutes and think about the answers to the questions. And one thing that I should point out, which is very, very important with this Mentimeter stuff, is that it is completely anonymous. Yeah, so whatever answers you choose to share with us today, we don't know where they're sent, where they're being sent from. We don't know who you are. It's completely anonymous. So you can feel free to send whatever you want, whatever feelings and thoughts you want to share. You can do that without any worries that we're going to, you know, that anyone will know who has sent that message. So what does safeguarding mean to you? For this first question, I'm going to turn to Romina, just while people, because you can see on Mentimeter, what does safeguarding mean to you? You should now have a screen. I'm sorry, my phone's really far away from the screen here, but you should have a screen where you can enter different keywords. So the idea for those of you at home is to think about, in a few words, when you hear the word safeguarding, what does that evoke for you? And we're already seeing these are the things that are coming up on screen. So I was going to turn to Romina. Romina, you were going to sort of commentate on some of the things that are coming up here.
Yeah. So when you found out about this event, probably thought about the word safeguarding. Maybe you didn't know what it meant. Maybe you had an idea. Maybe you discussed it with somebody else. Maybe you asked somebody else the definition. So we want to know what it actually means to you. What comes to your mind when you think about safeguarding? And we're seeing some words already: respect, protection, safety, safe environment, safe sport, protecting athletes. Some words in Spanish as well, empatía, empathy. That's awesome. You can write in whatever language you want to, and I can translate in case I know the language. Spanish, Portuguese, that's fine. Italian, probably. So we're getting protection as well.
Yeah, something I can point out to you actually, Romina, is that the way that this Mentimeter works is that the more people come up with a keyword, the bigger the word is. So protection, safety, and respect are the words that are sort of being repeated the most, that people are using the most. So, yeah, so I think let's carry on, Romina, because I think I understand that you, between all of you in the working group, you have come up with this kind of, based on what we just saw a few moments ago and what people have come up with, a proposed definition for safeguarding.
Yes. So a lot of words that came up on the Mentimeter actually have... are related to the definition that we have, which means for us, providing a safe environment where all participants can interact healthily in a sport free from harm and from inappropriate behavior or misconduct of any kind. That's the definition that we have for safeguarding, and we would like you to adopt as well. And remember that being safe at the gym, whatever discipline you participate in, is important, and it's also a right you have as a gymnast. Being safe and having means to raise concerns are also rights for you as a gymnast. So that's important for us. And I think Donatella has some ideas on the constellation that we're seeing on the screen as well.
Yes, Romina, because what just you mentioned as our proposal for definitions, we can consider as our constellation of values. You see all these stars. And actually the safeguarding for FIG now becomes the polar star, the guide we have to follow.
Yeah, very nicely put. Thank you both for your input there. And so why is safeguard, again, simple questions, but important questions to be asked. Why is safeguarding so important in gymnastics? I'm going to hand over to answer this question. I'm going to hand over to Emma and to Sasha. So perhaps Emma, we'll start with you. And what do you make, where do you start answering this question?
So I believe that the safeguarding group is so important because the athletes need to have a voice. There has been so many of us that have had the courage to come forward, and it's the duty of FIG to protect their athletes. And too many athletes have experienced or witnessed things and don't know what to do about it. And they don't know the proper procedures of reporting or bringing forward any issues that they see. And sometimes the coaches need a reminder of what is acceptable and what is not, because the same negative coaching behaviors have been going on for decades, and there needs to be a change in that because the old coaching practices are not acceptable, and too many athletes feel stuck and don't know that there is hope for a better training environment. And sometimes not everyone feels like they can speak about any issues they may have, and we want them to know that there's a way, the proper way to do it, and that they don't feel alone. And we really just want to bring hope to the athletes that they are not alone, that they can do well and thrive in a safe and healthy environment. And we want to be a part of that change.
Yeah. And that's very important, isn't it? All that sort of, I think something that we're going to explore as we go on through this webinar is that idea of not knowing, you know, when you are faced with a problem, is not knowing where to turn to. And that's something that we will revisit a little bit later on in the webinar. So we have a series of questions here that between Emma and Sasha are going to kind of talk about these questions. And again, this is back on Mentimeter. So those of you at home can get back on your phones when this question comes up. So again, it's you can just put us, I think it's a series of words. And here we go. It's all starting to come up on the screen now. So Emma, when you see what people are writing here, excited, energized, tired, safe, secure, happy, confident, special. That's but you can see uncomfortable, afraid of my coach. There's a bit of everything, I suppose.
Yeah, no, like personally, I've had many different experiences and emotions while going into practice throughout my career. There's been times where I was scared of going to the gym and just didn't want to be there because of the negative environment that I was in at the time. But that changed a while ago once I got myself in a positive training environment, and that all changed. And I was more excited to be at the gym with my coaches, my friends, to be able to teach the new skills, work on the routines. And it almost became like an outlet for me. So I've had my experience of both sides of it, but yeah, I mean, overall, I think telling that part, how there's been the negative side, is just as important as saying that there's been the good side of it, because that kind of gives hope to people that you can be happy again. And if you're in a negative situation right now, you aren't stuck in that situation forever, which honestly, at one point, I used to think that I was. So it's almost, I guess, important to show that side of it too on here. So, yeah.
No, that's great. Perhaps Sasha, I could just bring you in as well. I was just looking at some of the responses that we've had, and you seem to, even in the three words, there seem to be some people, you know, you can be at the same time feel excitement, but also feel dread. I'm probably the only person at this meeting who is not a former gymnast. But Sasha, do you understand that kind of almost having these different emotions, conflicting emotions sometimes when you're in the gym?
First, hi to everybody. I can relate to that. You know, it is gymnastics is hard. You know, it's not easy, and it's not always easy to come to the gym. But you know, there is a line which we must not cross. One is hard sport, and one is abuse. You know, that's the main basic thing that we are talking about here. You know. So I can relate to that. It's sometimes they are happy to come to the gym, and they are also tired. But you know, first of all, you have to enjoy in gymnastics, and because you enjoy gymnastics, then you are able to train hard. For me personally, you know, it is really important the environment, the safe environment in gymnastics. Because I'm a father of the boys, young boys, you know, so I would like for them to experience the full, the everything that gymnastics can offer, the beautiful side of gymnastics. So that is why I like it so much.
That's great. Thank you very much, Sasha. And again, we see another, just in the yellow box there, I have an injury and I still have to train. That's something that that's an issue that we're going to deal with a little bit later on towards the end of the presentation. But I'll move on. I think perhaps we'll move on to the next question. Thank you all, by the way, to all of you who are putting these answers up on Mentimeter. This is thank you for just sharing your different views on these subjects. So moving on to this next question. So when you talk about training, when you're talking about training to people who are not necessarily training with you. So, you know, when you're talking to your family, when you're talking to your friends, people who are perhaps outside the sphere of gymnastics in your life, how do you describe it? So we're just going to, again, just see different things coming up. I mean, as you guys, Emma, when you have been, if you've, you know, when you've had perhaps difficulties that you've alluded to, was that something that you felt that you could share with people outside of the gym, or was it difficult to express those feelings?
Yeah, honestly, I never really talked about the more difficult, challenging sides of it, like the negative environment and all that. I never really brought that forward with anyone. I usually kept that to myself. So when people would ask how practice was going, how it went, usually I would just focus on the positive parts, be like, yeah, I had a good day, I did this skill and this skill, and I'd explain that part of it, but I never really went into detail or told anyone about the other negative things that happened.
Yeah, well, I suppose it's a very difficult thing, and something that it's, again, hard for me, as I say, because not being a high-level athlete, but I'm sure that everyone who's listening in will resonate with them. And going back to what you were saying just before, giving them hope that things can be better and the environment can be improved is super important. Seeing some of the other things that are coming up now, I mean, hard work and challenge. We see, you know, the coach understands, we see that the coach is mean. So it really goes back to what you were saying before, Sasha, about, you know, keeping the good coaches on what Ali has said at the very beginning, and kind of getting rid of the coaches who are bordering on abusive. But anyway, we shall move on to our next question. And these questions are now getting a little bit, you know, intimate. So just a reminder that all this is totally anonymous, and that, you know, we're not really expecting any of you guys, Emma and Sasha, either to go too far into any of your personal histories either. So would you say that you train in a safe environment? And you can see that, well, what's coming in so far, that's pretty encouraging, Emma, what we're seeing up on the screen.
Yeah, no, I really like that. I was expecting it to be a little worse, honestly. So this is nice.
I agree with Emma. I'm happy that the yes and the most of the time is mostly answer that question.
But we'll move on to the next question. And again, a personal one. A difficult one. Have you faced a situation where you felt deeply hurt and a victim of harassment? So we shall see how the answers come here. It's interesting because we saw on the previous slide that the majority of people felt that they were training in a pretty good environment. But now there's a little bit more balance, shall we say. What do you make of this, Emma or Sasha?
Yeah, this one, I guess, is a little bit more specific. Compared to the last question. So seeing that there has been more people that have felt that they've been a victim of harassment or deeply hurt. I guess it shows more in these this type of question.
Yeah, and it shows that the... Yeah. Sorry, Sasha.
Yeah, sorry. I would just like to thank everybody for answering so honestly. You know, I think this is worrying. You know, this is the problematic part. You know, when people are answering yes several times and once, you know, even once is too much. And for everyone that is listening now, for the participants, once is not okay. Once is one time too much. So this is what we are talking about. Gymnastics is hard, but it should not be abusive to the gymnast. This is not okay.
Yeah, and people being honest on here is also important for us because it kind of shows us what we need to work on moving forward as the skateboarding working group. So yeah, thank you for being honest on here.
Yeah, and I mean, just because this is a very, just, I was just going to say, if there's anybody, I know I'm talking here to Emma and Sasha, I don't know if there's anybody else, perhaps there are others amongst you just on this point who want to intervene, who would like to say something, because this is a, you know, this is kind of the crux of the matter, really. You know, these are the issues that gymnastics is facing. And so this is, you know, it's via this communication and with you guys who know, who have been there in the gyms and know what these situations are, that we, you know, can hope to find solutions and improve the general culture of the sport. And this, again, this is a very important question as well. And we'll see how the answers go with this one. But if you had problems in the gym, with whom do you share it? I think, Emma, you alluded a little bit earlier on to the fact that sometimes when you have a problem, you just don't know who to talk to. And we can see that already, the yellow column there of nobody, because I don't know how to share that problem.
Yeah, so it's very difficult to know who to trust to, I guess, approach these situations with, I think, because you don't know if there would be any negative consequences towards yourself, towards whoever was treating you that way. Also, sometimes you just don't want to cause more problems by telling people about it. Honestly, at least that was my situation at the time.
Yeah, for me, it is nice to see that gymnasts still trust their parents. This is good. This is really good. But it is problematic that they don't trust their coaches. As you can see, this is a real problem. I'm also happy that they have friends, or I would be most happy if those friends were from the gym. So then they have someone to talk to at the gym. I don't know if they are, but I'm happy for the parents, and I'm sad that they don't trust the coaches. That is the problem.
Yeah, perhaps I could come back to Aliaz very briefly, because Aliaz, at the very beginning, you were talking about how it's important as well for coaches to have a certain amount of protection. And do you think this is this perhaps the key to how things can improve, as well as improving that relationship between the gymnasts and the coaches?
Yeah, the from my experience, I can tell you that I didn't feel that I was abused. But if I see now what abuse is, everything here, I can say, yes, I was abused, but I never felt it like abuse. And this is the very interesting for me. And I was afraid to go to the gym from my 13th of year when I changed my coach till, let's say, when I was 20. These 7 years was, every time I was afraid because my coach was so strict, but I never felt it like an abuse or something like that. I feel it like this is normal. After that, we were with my coach really good friends, and still now we are friends, and nothing happened, but I accepted it like it has to be if I want to achieve the results. So for me, I don't know what to say. It's sometimes it's difficult to understand for some things that some people feel it like an abuse. Maybe it's just the connection between the coach and the gymnast not so good, and then maybe is here some misunderstanding. I don't know. But the good connection between the coach and the gymnast, this relationship can help a lot if you can talk to your coach, discuss why this, but I know that when you're growing up, sometimes it's difficult also for the coaches and for the athletes, for sure.
Yeah, well, I think your answer there is super interesting, and it shows all the complexity as well of the question and of the, you know, being in high level sport as well. And I think we're going to, when we talk a little bit later on about the legal framework, I suppose, of what constitutes abuse and things like the code of conduct, then that we will start to see, and we'll hear a little bit more about that later, how these things can be defined and therefore punished. But yeah, thank you very much all of you for those insights on that one. So we'll move on to our next question, an important one. So if you are suffering, abuse, do you know where to go? You know, if you are gonna make a formal complaint, do you know to whom you can report a case? Well, seems to be a landslide here about where to go, whether it was the Court of Arbitration for Sport to the Gymnastics Ethics Foundation, the World Health Organization, or WADA. And it is indeed the Gymnastics Ethics Foundation. So I'm going to hand over to Alex now. Alex, you're going to talk to us. Well, you can see that everyone seems to know where to go. And you were going to talk to us a little bit about the work of the Gymnastics Ethics Foundation.
Thanks, Andy. As we all saw, most people know where to report, and that's really good. Most of you are right, and you can report to the Gymnastics Ethics Foundation. So what is the Gymnastics Ethics Foundation, you may ask? The GEF is an independent body established in 2019, which ensures that violations are handled in an unbiased way. The GEF confidentially receives any reports concerning non-accidental violence, harassment, and/or abuses, and creates resolution for such matters. The GEF focuses on three main aspects: safeguarding, disciplinary, and compliance. So how does the process work? The process for reporting issues usually starts with your own national federation, and each have their own internal processes dealing with integrity and safeguarding. If your national federation is unable to process your complaint in a timely manner, the issue can be escalated to the GEF. Sometimes one report is not enough, but several reports related to the same person can enable the GEF to have a strong disciplinary proceeding.
Thank you very much, Alex. So, and yes, we can see actually just upon the screen is a QR code that will take you to the page, I think, of the GEF, where you can fill out a form. And just in case, if you're still connected to Mentimeter and you've been taken off that, it will have opened in a separate window. But yes, absolutely. And you can file confidential reports, and the Gymnastics Ethics Foundation will take you through that, and you can find more information as well on their website. But thank you very much, Alex, for taking us through that. And I think as well, I mean, all these points, the last sort of 5-10 minutes, it goes to show that so much of this is about a change of culture in gymnastics as well, and kind of taking the fear out of the gym, I suppose, is the best way I could describe it. One of the things that came out or has come out of recent discussions here at FIG with the International Gymnastics Federations is the 10 golden rules. Now the 10 golden rules, the idea of the 10 golden rule, I'm going to hand over to some of the others to talk us through them. Well, first of all, we can try asking a question to see if people know what the 10 golden rules are. Is it a perfect score that a federation can reach with the implementation of safeguarding policies? Is it the 10 criteria for obtaining a certificate of good training practice? Or is it an awareness campaign on safeguarding that is based on 10 cartoons? Well, I think that most people are pretty clued into what the correct answer here is. And I can, in fact, show you. I have some props. These are all fairly hot off the press. So this is the version in Espanol for you guys from South America, for the Mexicans and the Uruguayans above us. Las 10 reglas de oro de la gimnasia. I think I have a version here as well in Arabic as well. Voila. So the 10 golden rules. So to tell us about the 10 golden rules, I'm going to hand over to Elsa and Victoria. Perhaps you can tell us what the golden rules are and how you guys, as the safeguarding working group, had a hand in bringing them about.
As you can tell by now, the safeguarding group, a working group, is made by people who care and have been involved in the gymnastic community worldwide. We're a passion group of gymnasts, coaches, judges from a different gymnastic discipline, such as artistic, rhythmic, aerobic, acrobatic, and parkour. We came together and wanted to make the golden rules of gymnastic as simple as possible for everyone from all ages to be able to understand. From the young age of a gymnast that just start the sport to a high level international competition gymnast. The golden rules are guidelines to live by on and off the sport that can be applied in every aspect of your life because they focus mainly on the value and practice of respect. Respect of yourself, respect of other people, respecting for your body, for your ideas, for your feelings, respecting and being tolerant of the other people's differences, even if they don't match your ways, thinking and doing.
Yeah, hi. To complement what Victoria is saying, for me, knowledge translates into power. So we would like athletes to regain their voice and their power so they can enjoy gymnastics in the best way possible. That means by having fun, first of all, training hard, and feeling safe while doing so. That is the most important part. And as a gymnast, you spend a lot of time far away from home, surrounded by your teammates, but mostly surrounded by adults, such as your coaches, judges, National Federation staff, even media people. So you should be able to feel safe, heard, and respected while working side by side with all of these different kinds of people. That's why here at the Safeguarding Working Group, we think it's really important for all of us to put these rules to good use. And one of the things that I like most about the golden rules is that one is not more important than the other. They're equally important. So that's what makes them so, so special. And so I don't keep on talking about it more. Many people have been behind this project and we are about to present the clip of the 10 golden rules of gymnastics.
Okay, so that was the clip of the 10 golden rules. And as you very eloquently said just a moment ago, Elsa, there is no order to the rules. Yeah, there's no 1 to 10. They don't have numbers. They're not like commandments, for example. They're just, there's 10 rules. So in no particular order, we're going to go through them. And I'm going to ask one of you to kind of talk to us about the theory behind the rule and the importance of the rule, really. So we're going to start with Maria first up. And you're going to talk to us about I Do Gymnastics for Fun.
Yeah, so the first golden rule is I do gymnastics for fun. As in any aspect of our life, of your life, being happy and loving what you do is an overall booster of productivity and enhances performance. As athletes who enjoy their sport, athletes or gymnasts who enjoy their sport are more likely to be optimistic, motivated, learn faster, make fewer mistakes, and better decisions. So this is what we need.
So we do gymnastics for fun. Thank you very much. Over to Alex for our next rule. I pursue my own dreams and not somebody else's.
Thank you, Maria. Another rule is I pursue my own dreams, not someone else's. It is important that your own personal goals and dreams drive you to success. Quite often, parents and coaches have long-term ambitions for their athletes. However, when the athlete doesn't share that ambition, sports becomes a burden and can lead to injuries. So do it because you enjoy it.
Very nice. Thank you, Alex. Back to you, Elsa, for this next one. I know we'll have good days and tough days.
Yeah, well, when you have a good day, you feel motivated and confident and happy all around. But when you have tough days, that's when you learn to build character and learn to get through the obstacles and have determination to reach your goals. And I think both days are a mixture of what you need to pursue your goals and finally prove to yourself who you are and what you are made of.
Very nice. Moving on to the next one, I listen to my body. Romina, I think you're going to talk to us about this one.
Yes, I really like this rule because it talks about listening to your body and actually recognizing that we are all different. We all do different skills, different levels of gymnastics, different disciplines. They're all valid. And the important part is that you enjoy and you progress in your career, no matter the level that you actually compete or train. And it's a process. Don't rush it.
Very nice. Thank you. Sasha, you're gonna talk to us about this next one, balancing your passion for gymnastics with other big goals, such as I think you mentioned earlier that you're in marketing and things like that, and spending time with the boys as well.
Yeah, like Elsa said, every rule is equally important, but I like this one very much. I've been in gymnastics for 30 years as a professional gymnast for 14 years, but I also know that it's very important to do something besides just gymnastics. So that's why I was going to school during my professional career, so that now when I retired, I have a good job in marketing, with which I can support my family and enjoy my life. So remember, you know, gymnastics is really important, but don't forget about other things that are also important in your life.
Yeah, nicely put. And as we saw at the start, several of you have already kind of started thinking about your career paths already post your professional careers or in the process of going in that direction. Onto the next rule, and we're going to go to Emma for this one. My health is more important than medals.
I think this one is very important, and the message behind it pretty much is that an athlete's physical, mental, and emotional health is the most important priority, because once you have that strong foundation, the medals and the results and everything will come.
Yeah, very nicely put. Thank you. Victoria, I have the right to be respected as I am.
Yes, I think it's one of the important rules here, because each of us has our own uniqueness. Everyone deserves equality, no matter what origin, race, religion, or skin color, or age, or what sport achievement you have. Everyone have a right to be respected.
Yeah, and that was exactly the point that Elsa made just before the clip as well, about it, how it's all about respect when you were coming up with these golden rules. And we have a couple more still. I think we're back to Romina for this one. I have the right to express myself freely, be heard, and be treated fairly.
Yes. So remember that your career as a gymnast is yours. This is your life. This is the sport you want to practice. So it's important that you have the right to express yourself, to raise concerns. You have a say in how you train, how you compete.
if you want to compete or not. And this is actually important because you are your best advocate. So you have to learn how to communicate and also discuss in case you don't know the means to raise concerns or anything at the gym. You have a right to know about that.
Perfect. So on to the last two of the golden rules. So Evdoxia, you're in a good position with everything that you've done to talk to us about this one, understanding and respecting the roles of the people around me.
Yes, that's why I chose it. As we know, gymnasts have a lot of people around them from their young age until they are championers. But I must understand and respect that everyone has a role, a significant role, and it's important, but it's a significant role about them. So to able to be a gymnast, many people around you have this significant but distinct role: coaches, physiotherapists, parents, judges, even officials, and they must do their part. You do your part and they will do their part. Thank you.
Thank you, Evdoxia. And finally to Alias, well, as a man who knows, not quite, perhaps not the right height of the bars, but a man who knows his way around the bars anyway. I think only you could have done this one for us, Alias. I act with fairness and integrity.
So this last rule is about fair play. Fair play is improving not only athletes' well-being, but also the quality of life. And again, from my experience, I can tell you that training and competing in a friendly, respectful, tolerant, and honest atmosphere is much easier, less stressful, and brings joy to the sport. So let's start again with the first rule. Let's do gymnastics for fun.
Yeah, bringing it around a perfect circle. Thank you very much, Alias. And so I'm just going to ping us back to Elsa and Victoria. You guys are going to tell us how people can get hold of the 10 golden rules.
Yeah, well, if you're as excited as we are about the 10 golden rules of gymnastics and you want to share them with your teammates, your coaches, your friends, your family, you can scan the QR code that you see on the screen and you will get redirected to a webpage where you can fill out a very basic information like your name, country, email, and you will get the poster in the language that you pick. We are actually really proud to tell you that the golden rules are available in 22 languages. So we are working towards making the whole world know about the golden rules and making gymnastics a safer and healthier sport.
Fantastic. And yeah, I can add as well that it is also available on the FIG website, which is gymnastics.sport. So you can also get hold of the golden rules there and download and print and put it in your gym or put it up on your wall at home. And I think a little bit later on, I think we'll also be talking about, there's a hashtag as well that you can use to talk about the golden rules and to share on social media. We'll come back to that a little bit later on. So that was fantastic. Thank you all for giving us a very sort of detailed look at the golden rules. And obviously, it's fantastic to have an awareness campaign like the golden rules. And the point was made in there that it was the golden rules. You wanted it to be something that even from a very young age, that children who are maybe just discovering gymnastics at the age of 3 or 4 or 5, they can kind of relate to and they can understand the points that are being made there. But as well as that, of course, there has to be a strengthening of the kind of the official framework. So we're going to move on now and talk with Alex. Alex is going to talk to us a little bit about this concept of strengthening the rules and how things have changed in terms of, you can see just coming up on the screen, the statutes, the code of ethics, the code of conduct, and the code of discipline. So Alex, I'll hand over to you.
So the 10 golden rules define how gymnasts can participate in sport in a safe environment and with much enjoyment. But this cannot be done without regulating all participants in sport, like coaches, judges, and administrators. Here we will see different codes provided by the FIG and applied to all gymnastics members. Strengthening the rules was necessary to have a strong legal framework, which allows us to tell when there is a breach of rule or a breach of violation. We all worked very hard on the code of conduct, and in May, the FIG has adopted a new code of conduct. Maria and Evdoxia can tell us more now.
Thank you, Alex. So to understand the code of conduct, we need to understand the meaning of the word conduct. which is the manner in which a person behaves, especially in a particular place or situation. Now, so we going back to the FIG code of conduct, we said now a person, behavior, place or situation, right? The person abiding by the FIG code of conduct, collective commitment and individual responsibility are all who participate in the sport. Remember this. The behavior we're talking about is a transparent and ethical conduct and dedication. As for the place or situation, the code covers all aspects of training, competition, and sports operations. But for why does this policy or this code exist? Why it's there? Why the FIG stresses on it? Why we worked very hard, us and many other people? Well, to put it simply, is to ensure a safe environment for everyone.
I think there's a question that's going to come up on the screen about for whom the code is made, for who does the code of conduct. So those of you who are still here and still connected to Mentimeter, you might need a moment to go back into your phone and find the right tab. Well, looks like the people who are responding know what they're about, because I think Evdoxia, I think you wanted to carry on, and that is the right answer, isn't it?
I see it's obvious that it is made the code of conduct about everybody who is involved in gymnastics, in all aspects of gymnastics. The code has been changed to include all participants committed in it. That means that the code has been changed to include all kinds of stakeholders. That means athletes, coaches, judges, all officials, everybody who is involved in gymnastics procedure. Also, the code has changed recently with general and specific provisions and broaden the scope of actions, not only for the World Championship, which is the greatest event, but also it's applicable to all gymnastic activities. That means training halls, competition venues, and even on social media or the digital work moreover. So there are general principles, but also there are specific principles for each participant. The code mentioned exactly what is committed an athlete to do, what is a coach committed to do, a judge, and all the other officials. So we have now a scene. As you sent Andy earlier, they have to answer us with something that is very common in the training halls.
Absolutely. Yeah. So you have an ankle injury, and this was something that came up on one of the earlier slides, as you pointed out, Evdoxia. So your coach tells you you have to train. The doctor is suggesting that you shouldn't train because it's an injury. So the majority of the answers seem to be saying that you follow the medical protocol and tell your coach that you can't train. And then some. What do you make of the answers to this? Is that surprising, or is that promising to see?
To tell you the truth, the answers come a little late. That means that people are thinking what to answer. It's not very quickly the answers as they were in the first questions in Mentimeter. That means that it's not very strict what you must do.
I think there's possibly also an element of it. I'm sure it must be different when you're in the gym, like as I'm sure that many of you could, or probably all of you could attest that it's one thing to answer in a webinar, and it's another thing to be in that situation when you're there in the gym and you're being told to train. So perhaps you can tell us about what the provisions are and the rules on this point.
Yes. So the coach commits to never overrule medical and paramedical experts, and he must respect medical advice regarding athletes suffering from any illness or injury. That's a rule. Mental health conditions, he must also respect these conditions or in prescribed treatment or in a recovery protocol, or who are returning to training. So a coach is committed to never overrule all these advices.
Yeah. Well, it's important. And that's what the message that you guys are trying to to convey today as well, is to give this information. And there was, I know that the link, there was a QR code for the code of conduct earlier, and all the links will be available at the end. So the heads of your federation blame you for not making enough efforts to win the competition, even if they know that you face serious family problems. Nobody seems to think it's normal to be blamed in that situation. Considered it as kind of harassment. And yeah, most people going for the answer there, that they consider that attitude a form of harassment.
So definitely, participants are right. It's a kind of harassment. If you heard Andy at the beginning, and Donatella and Alias, they all stressed about FIG's interest in athletes' voice, the importance and how athletes and gymnasts are at the core of everything that's happening, our work, FIG's work, the commission's work. So basically, yes, this is harassment, and we have to work on it.
Very well put, Maria. Thank you. So again, you can see the executive officer of a gymnastics federation commits to ensuring their federation makes decisions in the interests of the athletes and rejecting the win-at-all-cost strategies at the expense of athletes' well-being. So this is, do you want to be a part of it? I'm going to Victoria. To start us off on this, and I think perhaps Emma and Romina as well, we're gonna talk a little bit as well. But this is kind of being a part of this movement for change.
Yes. So as you probably understand by now, the 10 golden rules have a very important message, but not so many people are aware of it. In order to promote such an important idea, you can use the social media. For example, you can apply the way FIG did it by simple reaching out to the people through the social media. You can share the message. You can use the Facebook, the TikTok, Instagram, all social media platforms, and use your all imagination to be creative.
Some examples of ways you can participate in this little challenge thing we are doing is you can create a video of yourself representing your favorite golden rule at the gym. You could make a picture collage that represents your favorite golden rule. You could draw a picture to represent it. You can be as creative as you want and film it outside of the gym if you'd like as well, or in the gym. We're just very excited to see how creative you guys can get to help us advertise these golden rules. Because we definitely enjoyed the process of creating the messages and the characters for each one.
To participate, you can post your videos, your pictures, just like Emma said, get creative, share it on social media, and don't forget to use the hashtags that you're seeing on the screen right now, 10 Golden Rules of Gymnastics and Safeguarding for All, so the FAG can share those who are most creative, most fun, and we get to see what you have created. And if you have any questions about this, you can contact safeguarding@fig.sport as well. So can't wait to see what you have created.
And I don't want to get ahead of myself, but I heard that the FIG was talking about launching the TikTok profile. So maybe you can also use the hashtag through there. And we are all relying on you to also be an advocate for safeguarding around the world. Like, spread the word. We need this to get out and to be part of it, so we can all work together towards making the sport a safer sport. I mean, we want gymnasts to feel safe, heard, respected, and mainly have fun while doing so.
Thank you all, guys. Thank you very much. And yeah, so get on the hashtags, get on TikTok, and get making your videos. And even those of you who are tuning into to today's webinar, by all means, you know, use these hashtags and share that you were here. And as you guys have just been saying, spread the word. So we are actually getting pretty much to the end of our presentation of our webinar today. Just before, I was going to just ask, I was in a moment, I'm going to give the floor to Donatella. I just wanted to ask if any of you had any, because we're a little bit ahead of time, I just want to ask if any of you had any other just final messages that you wanted to leave. Elsa, did you want to say something?
Oh, well, yeah, I was thinking that you can reach out to us through our social media or directly to the FIG. I mean, we can help you get your message through, and don't feel scared. We're here to help. We are all athletes like you have been, and we know what it feels like to be maybe kind of trapped in a difficult situation in a sport that you love. So this is all about finding your way to feeling heard and to feeling safe in your sport.
Dora, I see you. You have your hand up. Go ahead.
Yeah, thank you. So I just want to join to Elsa, and make sure that's why you have your athletes representative of your discipline, that you also can count on us. On we also try to provide some education about safeguarding and safe sport during our athletes meetings. And hopefully in the future, not only for seniors, but for juniors and age group as well. So anything happens or any advice or any words you need, you can contact us also from the athlete side, like from the athletes commission.
Perfect. Thank you very much. Great stuff. Well, okay. If nobody else wanted to mention anything, I'll hand you back to the chair, to Donatella, and she's going to just tell us to finish off this webinar. She's going to tell us about Kintsugi. Over to you, Donatella.
Yeah, right. We are at the end now, so I can imagine everybody looking to this slide, thinking what we have to do with these cups and dishes. What is a kintsugi? So actually, kintsugi is an ancient Japanese art. It means that when a cup or a dish is broken, these Japanese glue the broken pieces with gold. And in this case, they create a precious and unique piece of art. For us, can be considered a metaphor of the changes. So from the bad experiences, we have now the opportunity to create a more valuable future. This is our goal, and this is what is our commitment. We strongly are committed to change the culture in sport and create for the future a safe sport for everybody, and give more value in this case to our beautiful sport, because it's the sport we love. Let me conclude thanking these wonderful people I have in the working group. They did for this long year great job, and a wonderful job today. Congratulations to all of you. I have also to thank them for their passion in this commitment. It's not only a job for them, but they applied as volunteer with really the goal to improve this sport. And I love to work with them, and I hope we can work longer. And we have actually many projects on the way. So there is many things to cook on the fire. And soon we will come back with much more. Thank you very much. And thank you for all the participants for listening us.
Fantastic. Well, thank you very much, Donatella. Thank you to all of you. Yeah, round of applause. I think that was lovely. So yeah, this is the end of our webinar, but you know, get onto social media, get sharing with the hashtags, tell people to come and watch the webinar if they didn't get a chance to watch it live with us today. Thanks to all of you in the Safeguarding Working Group. Thanks to all of you watching at home. And yeah, look forward to the next round of the feast, as Donatella was saying. And yeah, goodbye for now. Cheers.
Bye, guys. Thank you.
Bye.